All right. Well, hi, I'm Tara DeFort, and I'm really excited to be here with Christine Arroyo and Claudia Schneider, and Natasha Williams will hopefully be, oh, she's joining us right now. And this is our second Impact Hour of 2017, Engaging Beyond the Choir. And we're gonna have a very casual conversation, and you guys certainly, for the live audience, the huge live audience here, feel free to ask questions throughout. And hi, come on up, we just started. Nice to meet you. And this is Natasha Williams as well. This is the live streaming, and then so occasionally when I talk to that, no, that's why I'm not this crazy. So I was just gonna do introductions of these three amazing ladies, and then we'll get started. I'll start with Natasha, you're first on my list here. And Natasha is a political strategist, a social architect, and a community engager. Who recently helped organize the Women's March on Washington and around the world, which was one of the largest global demonstrations in American history. And with a total of 5 million people participating globally, I'm sure all of us in the audience know of that. And previously she was the executive director of the New York State Black, Puerto Rican, Hispanic, and Asian Legislative Caucus. And has also been featured in many media outlets like Vogue, Essence, Hello Beautiful, and MTV. So you guys can talk about MTV later. And then we have Claudia Schneider, who's a fellow at the Center for Research on Environmental Decisions at Columbia University, and a graduate student in psychology with a background in stuff probably none of us understand, but neural and behavioral scientists and international business. So a really interesting combination there. And her work at CRED investigates environmental decisions, making it cross-cultural context, as well as societal and personal norms. So I'm excited to see what you have to say about how do we reach beyond our own norms to reach others. And then Christine Arroyo, who is not only a new advisory member for the Human Impacts Institute, but she is also, for the past 10 years, have been a creative director of music videos and live events from the Black Eyed Peas World Tour to the Academy Awards, the Grammys, and American Music Awards. I think we've all heard of those things too. And she also has done music video work for artists such as Katy Perry, Pink, and Jay-Z. And she won the best music video of the year for Fireworks from Katy Perry, which I always, like, that imagery is stuck in my head, and I think we'll come back to that about how the imagery stays with you and can really share stories. So ladies, thank you so much for being here today. I'm really excited to learn from you, and one of the reasons we picked this topic is particularly right now in the U.S., it seems like there's a struggle for dialogue across lines, and to it's so easy for us all to get our information from things we agree with, to talk with people that we agree with, to hang out with people that look like us, and it's just easier now, and to, you know, defriend or just not listen to the rest of them. So we thought it would be an important conversation, and I wanted to start off with asking you your thoughts of this idea of what is beyond the choir, if we're even talking about this, and if we're... And I'm going to do a two-part, which is a bad place to start, but I'm going to do it anyways. So what is this, you know, beyond the choir, if we're talking about reaching outside? And also, is it worth our time?
I'll start.
Okay.
In the projects that I've worked on, not being climate-related necessarily, but with people who have very competing visions and ideas about how something will turn out, it's very easy to get lost in a continual dialogue that never results in action. And I think what I'm trying to take away from the lessons I've learned in working with so many different people with their own valid opinions is to not try and change people's minds, but to say, let's focus on what we can agree on, which for me, whether or not people want to agree about climate change being real, innovation and design is a very important thing to be putting our focus on. So that means designing in a way that can be better for the entire environment, all the people that it would impact, and to let that be what's inspiring people instead of getting lost in the getting everyone on the same page. Like if that was my goal, we would never get anything done in the advertising world. We just, somebody has to say, all right, well, where do we want the innovation to take us, and to let that be what inspires us.
And then Tasha, with organizing the women's march, particularly, you had so many different people and interests and goals. What do you think? What is beyond, you know, who are we reaching out to if we're talking about this potentially? And is it, if we're talking about getting stuff done, particularly, what do you think? Is it worth our time?
Yeah, so I think the Women's March was unique, that it did reach beyond the choir, and to a negative effect on people that are a part of the choir, right? And so, you know, it was bizarre because after the election, all of these people that normally would not really care sort of had their world turned upside down, and they wanted to do something, right? But there were people already in these spaces, particularly marginalized communities that have never, like, slept and have always been kind of involved in these movements. And so there was a disconnect, and I know internally Women's March, we always talk about that. Like, there was a big disconnect in historically marginalized communities, and then all the tons of people that showed up, which if you look, it looks like a sea of white women, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which isn't as accurate, because there were people there. There were people a part of the national organizing community that were women of color, even, you know, guys, right? So there was some diversity, but I think largely it was kind of the reverse. But I think beyond the choir means sort of going past the people that you're normally talking to that understand the same song as you, and trying to figure out what other songs and other people are singing and how to get everybody on the same note, right?
Yeah.
That's kind of how I,
that's
how,
hard.
Yeah, that's how I think about it, and it's really hard because, you know, especially in these spaces that we're mentioning now, a lot of the people that are sort of beyond the choir are so disengaged. So it's not even about like getting people on the same side as you or understanding your side. It's really about like activating and empowering them to just even be engaged.
Mm.
And then once they're engaged, then having, you know, courageous and daring discussions to really reach points of intersectionality. So it's so complex, and I do think that it is worth it, because we have to try to be unified and to really operate from a point of solidarity, but it is difficult sometimes, and sometimes it does feel like you're turning the wheel and not seeing tangible results.
Yeah, and we'll definitely come back to it. You pulled up a lot of things we're going to talk about later, and that's certainly something that we're very action-oriented as an organization, and we think a lot about, you know, how do we spark environmental action? So it's not... Dialogue is amazing, and it's often seen as a first step to many things, but if it doesn't ever lead to action, like if we're dealing with something like climate change, the dialogue doesn't really help, you know, if it doesn't eventually. But the more people you get in the room, the more opinions you have and perspectives, so that balancing act can be really hard. And I'm wondering, Claudia, on this first, I always like to start down low and then build us high. So, like, is it worth it? You know, it's my first question. Then we're end positive. Don't worry. What do you think about?
Absolutely worth it.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
All right, we're all on the same page.
Yeah. I mean, like, we're talking about issues that affect us all. Like, we all live together in this world, right? So we can't just like leave half of the world or whatever the percentage is out and like not try to engage them. And like, sort of in research and in psychology, this like beyond the choir, the notion comes down to this idea of like individual differences. Like realizing that there's some overarching concepts that like, you know, kind of speak to everybody and kind of like human, but then there's also like different worldviews and like values that different people have, and they need to be addressed differently.
Mm-hmm.
And if we're not careful and like really first understanding our audience and like who we want to reach, then some things could even backfire. So it's really kind of like doing like the groundwork and like understanding who are these people, like what do they care about, and then sometimes it really comes down to like framing things in a way that like matters to them, because then they listen, and then it like opens the door for people to like listen, to understand, to want to engage, like want to be involved, and like happen down.
So we've established that all of us up here think it's worth it. We're gonna and that it's difficult. And it's really hard, particularly, you know, when you have so many different voices. And maybe with this idea of reaching beyond what we know, we're also, we don't know. That's one of the issues with reaching a new audience. So I'm curious if we can learn then from some failures you've had in your careers in terms, because I think we often learn from the stuff that doesn't work. When you've tried this, then maybe a certain tactic hasn't worked to engage new audiences. Christine, you had an example I really liked, that it was something you had said, it's less about what you think the audience wants to hear and more about coming from an emotional and sincere point of view that isn't preachy. Could you have more of an example with that? Or?
Well, some of the videos I've worked on, like Firework being one, have dealt with speaking to people who feel disenfranchised, right? Especially for the young audiences that Firework really spoke to. It was part of the campaign to really get people talking about you know, fears of bullying and not feeling like they fit in, and weight issues, and abusive domestic home situations. And so these are very deep issues that were being talked about, or not being talked about. More things like 13 Reasons Why are addressing that. But it's like, how could we get people to be thinking about this conversation that is so challenging, that there wasn't a place for people to feel like they had a voice? And so it can't, instead of being preachy, like, don't feel that way, it was like, we understand how you feel. And then, and these are the images, that the imagery and the experiences that speak to what those feelings look like. And they come from this very like feeling based of empathy, was a way to start that conversation going. And people were engaging with that all over the world in terms of sharing their stories as part of the promotion of the video, and feeling like they could connect in a way that wasn't going to be judged or told they were wrong or to not feel that way. And I think that that, coming from a feeling-based point of view in my work, has been something I've really learned is important, instead of intellectualizing the challenge or how to come about storytelling, just to come from a very passionate, authentic, heartfelt way.
Hmm. Yeah, well, that comes back to some of what you're saying, of finding those commonalities of, and the humanness of, you know, the diversity of emotions we all have is something that we can connect to. Even, I mean, I think I've seen many examples of when we don't even speak the same language, where we can connect through that. Mm-hmm. And Natasha, you had said something that I thought was really important on this, of engaging earlier. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe that relates to some of what you were talking about before, in terms of, you know, there are a lot of people that have been doing this work, we can call this work many different things, mm-hmm. for a long time. And so not just coming in and saying, hey, I've got a great new idea, let's do this.
Yeah. That happens like with every issue, right? Like in the activist space, so like even if like climate change, like there are people that have been doing things on climate change for so long, and then now there's a new wave of people doing stuff on climate change. And you know, I think for a lot of people that are like new to these spaces, I think it's important, if you do have this like really great idea, that you first take time to learn what has already existed and respect that space, and then do it earlier on. And so like I was just speaking from the perspective of the Women's March, and I mean, the it's so hard to compare the Women's March, because it was just really like a ridiculous, crazy thing that it's really hard to say what you could have done differently, because everything happened really fast. But I do feel that, you know, how the Women's March originally started was a little bit controversial in terms of the naming, and then didn't do that good of a job to sort of turn it around, and a lot of people did feel that we were reaching out to them on the back end, even though that was not necessarily the case, but they did feel that way. And so I think when you're really trying to engage people and you're trying to go beyond the choir, that you really start to engage people before you decide to do something, or before you even have this great idea, that you really take time to like engage and learn about the space. And I'm just thinking about other community stuff, like in politics, right? Like when people come to different communities and, you know, have different projects, and then don't take time to like fully engage the existing people there. It's like, to to me, that's me always. I probably people that are not really sort of bought into what you're doing, and you have a lot of pushback from that. And something that I thought about that's related but not related with the conversation is that I think we tend to think about issues in a linear way, right? So like even when we, I'm always thinking about it in so many ways, even when we think about climate change, some of the conversations around climate change don't address environmental justice. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, even within the spaces, there's issues because you might just be thinking about reducing carbon emissions, right? And not realizing that there are people in a whole other community that live next to factories. And that's a huge issue for them just as an everyday thing. Like maybe every day you aren't breathing in toxins because you don't live by factories, but there are people that do. And like, I think that just goes back to the intersectionality of like a lot of the issues that we have, and I think that's the best way to sort of reach beyond the choir, because there are tons of people that are living in environmentally unjust neighborhoods that don't care about climate change. Mm-hmm. And it's not the group of people that are out there fighting for us to care about climate change. And the reason why is because it's like what you said, we're not really speaking to their language or speaking, or somebody, one of you said, you know, we're not really catering to the things that they care about.
Yeah.
And they're the main people that should care about climate change, but they aren't.
Yeah, and that's something that we think a lot about as an organization, of like, how do we make these issues more personal? Like, if we think of our daily lives, of like, what do we, on our to-do list, that's like, as New Yorkers particularly, you know, our 20 to-do lists, you know, and the things that are important in our lives, what do we prioritize? And how, you know, if we're trying to activate, if I'm trying to activate you, I need to know what's on that list and relate what I'm talking about to that. And that was something that you had talked about with the knowing your audience, but particularly, can you simplify this idea of framing an issue in different ways for us? Because I know that as a psychologist, you think about that a lot, and I think having a practical understanding of what that means would be great.
Very broad.
I know.
But like, very simply speaking, it's just using different wording, explaining the same problem, the same topic, the same idea in different ways. So just as an example, when you think of the environment and climate change and like why we should engage, for you know, one group of people who like care deeply about the environment and are like on board with the idea, yes, you know, climate change is real and we like need to do something. Like, we use one kind of language, but then for other people, where they're like, no, like, why should I care? Like, this is not real anyway. Then kind of framing it, like, rewording in terms of, you know, like, think of, like, preserving the beauty of nature for your children, you know, or, like, bringing it into a health context. So just, like, rewording the problem in, like, terms that they care about, that they understand, and where they not just, oh, you're just trying to, like, you know, put this into my mind, and I don't care about this issue, you're just trying to tell me that what I think is wrong. Because that's another mistake that we make, and once that happens, there's just like reactance. So it's really like framing it, wording it, so that they understand it and it speaks to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you had an example, because I love like specific examples too, that was about specifically reaching out to Democrats and Republicans, and that in terms of coming back to this idea of failure and learning from that, that you'd use some of the, you or some studies had used some of the same language for the two groups and actually got exact opposite reactions in terms of action. And can you give us a little teaser on that one too?
Yeah. Well, that was actually very similar to what I just talked about a little bit. So, like, in the environmental domain, because everything is, like, so heavily polarized, we always, like, look at the different, like, political affiliations, like, different political camps in our studies. And we tend to see a particular difference with, like, Democrats and Republicans. And in this study, like, at first, of, like, how we measured engagement, we tried this, like, particular intervention to, like, motivate people to be more pro-environmental, to want to do more pro-environmental actions, like taking public transport more often, or, like, using reusable mugs and things like that. And we measured these, like, behavioral intentions in sort of, like, a very environmentally framed way. And that worked really well with the Democrats, like the kind of intervention that we use, like, you know, they really like, increase intentions. But then for Republicans, we saw like an opposite effect. Such as like people in the like control group where they just like we don't do any intervention with them. We basically just like test, you know, how do you think on these issues? Like, how do you behave? What do you want to do in the future? They were kind of environmental, like where we had given like this sort of induction. And then we were like, okay, like maybe it's about the framing. So then we like reworded things, and that was actually more in a context of like bringing like a human connection, right? Like sort of like helping someone to like do something good, like kind of like more feeling based, more emotion based. And then we saw that this difference like went away and like got kind of closed. So to like really show that, you know, it's kind of like important there is like realizing that there's issues with certain words that some people are just like, it's like a no go for them. It's like, I'm like, what? Or just yeah. speak to them, knowing that, and then adjusting communication. Kind of goes back to what you said, like, you can't have one message that like speaks to everybody. You kind of really have to.
Yeah, and I think like personalizing it, thinking within your own life, like if someone were to come up to you on the street, and there are probably a few things that they could say to you where you'd be like, no, I'm done. Like, I'm not going any further. And like realizing that each of us have different triggers like that, but we don't necessarily know what they are because we don't know each other yet, is a big one. And so I want to start moving into the positive stuff that although I think all of this is fun. Positive so far. And I also wanted to see for any members in the audience, do you have any questions so far at all?
I would love to ask what practical tips you might have for understanding someone's perspective. Because we are not doing that groundwork, doing the research ahead of time or what's come before. Has there been an example for you where you can cite something that was successful, a tactic that was successful to really understand someone's perspective before offering your thoughts?
And I also love, because I actually say, like, what are some practical tips from your expertise? I was like, that's so well done.
You're like, here's what you should
But I think that's a great place to go. Because that's something, particularly with these conversations, we're trying to, like, not just have another dialogue, but even have some ways, how do we actually implement the stuff that we're talking about? So do you have any examples from... Anyone
want to
go?
For me, it'd be very feeling-based, like connecting with someone on what their feelings around the topic are. Like, this all sort of dovetails with what's been said before, but the core things that we care about collectively as humans really do have a lot of overlap. And so getting to where that is, where that intersects, and using that to disarm the intellectual opinions or preconceived ideas that people have, at least in my work, that being so feeling and emotion based, that's an important way to stay focused on the things that you have in common and to let that drive it instead of getting lost in the opinions and the judgment or the trying to impose your opinions on someone else. So I think in the feeling, staying focused on that and letting that inspire the next actions has always been very successful for me.
And if I can just add to that, like on a very practical level, I think like listening and like speaking like research terms, like trying to get a sample of your audience, like running like focus groups, and you know, like it really depends what you're trying to do. It's like one-on-one conversations or like bringing people together and just kind of like see how do they feel about a topic, what kind of words come up, like, you know, do you see certain like themes and like how people think about this or like talk about it, you know, kind of like words that they use, and then like really like using that as a groundwork to see like what makes them different and like what ways and like what speaks to them and how can I adjust my like messaging or my communication or my approach from there on after.
And also on that point, I think actually listening, what you're saying, like there's a lot of shouting in terms of the social media structure we now live in, and there's not a lot of listening, and so I feel like the reciprocity to that, creating spaces that you as an individual are part of or organizations that you're part of where people feel like they can really be heard, that's very important in the space. And then just to let that be and then see what comes of it next.
Do you have something?
Nope. I was going to say listening, and the only thing I would add is like honest listening, right? Because you can listen but not really listen or not really care even though you're listening. So I would say like being extremely genuine and honest about your listening is important.
Yeah, that really resonates for me because I know I've definitely, you know, I love to say I have an open mind and all that stuff, but honestly, when I really disagree with someone's stance, you know, we could say with climate change, I've definitely sat with people that, you know, start telling me that it's because I have a liberal education and all those things, and I know that's very much their core belief, And it's really hard for me to listen with empathy and to reply in a way that's constructive mm-hmm. anyway. So I wonder if you have anything to add. Is that issue with also not wanting to give power to something that you very much disagree with? And there, sometimes we have to, not necessarily, you know, one issue with the climate, a lot of climate communications people have said is that we've given so much space to climate deniers, you know, often an equal space in media to climate denial and to, you know, the, all of the everyone else, which it's not in the, you know, outside of media coverage, it's not a 50-50, but it can often look like that. So do you guys have any ideas on that in terms of when, I'm not forming a question well, but when do we engage deeper and listen more honestly, and when is the time maybe to say, well, I don't want to give that idea more of a platform? Or, do you have any thoughts on that?
I think it comes back to what you were saying at the beginning, is that feel like that conversation, we've gotten lost in it collectively and lost track of the action that can be taken. And instead of the things that I think all of us can agree on for the most part in terms of innovation and design, we look at the companies that really inspire us in the United States and around the world. They're all striving for better ways to do things, better conditions for people, and environmentalism is part of that. But I think if we've been speaking with people who are going to be so opinionated against that, can find common ground in terms of let's all be working toward improving and doing something better and moving forward. We're not here to move backwards. Mm-hmm. And so I think that sort of circumventing the argument and the dialogue in terms of like what we all can agree, I would hope, about wanting to improve where we're going collectively. Mm. To let that drive it instead of getting lost in a never-ending dialogue, a debate that's never going to necessarily have a conclusion.
And Natasha, you've worked a lot in the social justice world as well, and there's certainly, I mean, I could see a lot of examples of like, no, we can't tolerate this type of conversation.
Yeah, so, you know, I don't know if it's an interesting perspective, but I think, and Linda Sarsour, who's like a big sister, she's like, she always says this, and it's true, right? Like, when people are like, oh, we're not trying to change the minds of, like, the Trump supporters, right, just to, like, be blunt. Like, we're really trying to change the minds of, like, all the other millions of Americans that didn't come out to vote, that are disengaged, because we find that is the easier lift. And so I think that can be applied here, right? Like, you know, there you should have daring discussions. You should have honest listening, but there are some people that, you know, you're just not going to agree with, and what we really should do is turn our attention to those people that we can really inspire, engage, and empower to action, right? And a lot of that is finding ways to be intersectional, still finding ways to speak the language, and still going beyond the choir, right? Because there's tons of people, like I said, that didn't vote, but, you know, for those people that are, like, so far on one side, there is that level of like, well, we should change our attention to people that are really in the middle, that just haven't been activated. And I think there's so much, I guess, opportunity there that is missed opportunity. Instead of us like being negative, going back and forth, and like we really need to like figure out how to speak to all of these tons of people that really maybe don't have an opinion or don't care. You know, I think that's important.
Yeah,
if that kind of
like definitely, and that was something I hope we're gonna get to. So thank you. Do you have anything on that?
Just to add, I think that's very interesting and also very important. And then from a like a psychological perspective, it makes absolute sense because like as human creatures, so like social norms and like social signaling and like feeling part of the group is like very important to us, right? Mm-hmm. So if we get more of those people who are just kind of like just don't really care or like disengaged or not necessarily on like either side of the camp, so to say, and we get them to like, you know, engage, do some good behavior, whatever that like is, and then you know, gradually it kind of like increases the pool of like people engaging in a certain kind of behavior, having like certain attitudes, certain like views, and that kind of like signals to like others too, right? And so like with this like change in behavior, maybe that's also another way of kind of like changing attitudes of other people gradually, because like if we see that we're like very different from like everybody else, like that is a signal. Sometimes we want to be different, but like if it's on sort of issues where like, you know, like the crowd does this and you know, I want to be part of it, that is like a very powerful human driver that can be leveraged. So I think it does make sense to speak to them, try to get them on board, and then kind of.
I feel like as much as, you know, I don't love racist people, I don't love people that deny climate change, but I mean, this world is about polarity. We all can't think the same. And so even though I disagree with a lot of different things, I still respect that thought. Like, this is how you feel. I don't think you should have all of this hate and bigotry in your heart and anti-feminism views, but like, this is your view, right? Mm-hmm. And then it is a point, and I think psychologically, where sometimes you're just not gonna change that view. It's like decades and decades and decades, generations and generations of this type of thought. And you're not going to change that view, and I think that's important. But I do think it's important that we ensure that the voices of like love and like, you know, unification and like all the other good stuff that, you know, we feel that we should have in this world, those voices are the majority voices, right? And that these other voices are just really a small fraction of dissent. And so I try to like operate from that perspective, like not totally trying to like quiet them out, but just make sure that our voices are louder than theirs.
Yeah, and that comes to a great point as well, is that the loudest voice isn't always mean that they're the most voices behind it as well.
Right.
So that might be something for us in terms of engaging beyond too, is how do we amplify?
Mm-hmm.
How do
right.
we do that? And that would be in some ways, because we work a lot on, you know, personalizing environmental issues like climate, which climate, as Claudia knows particularly, but all of you can probably guess, is one of these like communications, like it's the best case of the worst type of thing you could try to communicate, because it has all of, it's like the Bermuda Triangle of communication. It's complicated, it's not in person, you know, it's not super personal. It's, there's a time lapse, and humans are like really bad at planning stuff. Really, you know, we do something now and you have effects that happen later or somewhere else. Like, it's just all these things that we don't deal with very well. You know, our brains don't actually deal with it well. And I see you nodding like, yes, I know, I do test with MRIs on this. I actually see your brains not working well on this. So I'm wondering, like, how, if we take these, and like, racial, you know, looking at race in America, like, that is not a simple issue. You know, justice and equity in our communities. So how do we take these complex issues, again, if we're trying to both communicate and spark action, how do we talk about these complex issues in ways that are more effective?
We were speaking about this before this event began, and saying how positivity and individual agency is a really great way for also to engage those who are disenfranchised, who feel like their actions don't matter. There's a lot of fear around how climate issues are messaged, and I think that encourages more disillusionment and disengagement. And so we were to take the principles that I use in terms of advertising and, or even getting someone excited about a new song, it's all very positive. It's your voice matters, and you can take action that makes a difference. And I'm trying in my community and with my friends and to say, look, give up those summer straws. That's gonna actually make a difference. And to be positive about where those individual actions can take someone, I think is going to flip things around.
I love it because you touched on so many aspects of decision science. Like,
I've read your the CREDS handbook on climate communication.
Great.
Many times.
I actually brought them both.
Okay.
Yeah, so I mean, like, in general, that like anything that speaks to our affective system is like so much more engaging and like sparks behavior more than.
And what do you mean by affective system?
Emotions,
okay.
Feelings, as compared to the analytic system. So
I
like, one of the like Kahneman's famous like system one, system two, it was like dual process kind of model. It's really like it's important that we make things like bring it down to like the emotional and like feeling level. As you said, I think that's one very important point, because if it's just like statistics and like figures, people are just like going to not engage. But then also like you talk about like the like huge time differences, like bringing it to the here and now, like how does it affect your life or like your children's life, but not talk about, oh, in like 20 years if you're sick of like the climate example, you know. Does person with many like degrees, like that's the warming, like that's what's going to happen, but like how does it affect you? And then like you also touched upon this like agency, so like really engaging them, so like this is what you can do and whatever you do matters, you know, it's not just a drop in the bucket, because with these issues it just seems so big and like what I do doesn't even matter at all. So like really bring it close in time, like close to the person, like to the community. I'm sure something, but then it's just like fear, and then people just like disengage as well. It's like find a pool of worry, like we just can't worry about a million things. So like really being very like, there is an issue, like this is why it matters to you, but like this is what you can do, and like then you know things will get better, this will be effective, and like you know like bring people in, and then this test again about like positive emotions. Oh, I can actually do something, I can feel good about it, these people want to feel good about themselves, and that engages further action, then you get the sustainability. So I feel like that's really kind of like,
and I can see you getting more excited as you talk about it, which is great. But that personal, I mean, I think the messenger matters a lot too.
Absolutely.
And particularly, we talked about this in our last Impact Hour, that acknowledging that we might not be the best messenger for whatever community we're working with. So great, you want to work with whatever, you want to work here in Williamsburg. Well, you know, if you're from somewhere else and you don't know the local culture and you don't know anybody here, you might not be the best, you know, maybe you can help and join the community, but you might not be the best leader or the messenger. So sometimes, like, you know, having that humility is, I think, for me it's hard sometimes because I want to do it. I'm ready to go. But you're nodding your head.
No, I agree. No, I disagree with it. I agree with everything. You know, there's a lot of conversations of, you know, that's why there's a big push to have more women in office, because it's that same thought process. Because if you're in these leadership positions, you operate and you make decisions based off of what your experience is. And I think that applies to just like messaging too, right? Like you message based off of your own experiences, and if you're trying to reach certain demographics and you don't have similar experiences, then your messaging is just gonna be flawed, like before you even start. So I think that is important to make sure that you have the right person delivering the message, that you are making it individualized, because that is super important. And I don't think people realize how much of their having courageous and daring discussions at the dinner table really matter. You know, so many people didn't have conversations. So we're in the situation that we're in right now because people weren't having conversations with their family, with their friends. And so I think, like, bringing it back to that, like, very individualized level is really important. And I also think about things, and this is probably my government perspective, because I'm more of a government person than a social activist person, which is interesting. I'm always, like, in the middle, right? Because I get it, and, like, they're my friends, and I love them, but then I've also worked for a government, too. And so I think from a government perspective, and I really want to do, like, research on this, so this is, like, a hypothesis, but my hypothesis is that government policy really shapes culture in the long run, right? So if you look at the different laws that we've had in this country, it has shaped our culture, right? Slavery was legal. This shaped everything that this country was based on, right? And so, like, even if you go to now, like, certain policies that certain cities or states, or, you know, Trump left the Paris Accord, is it what's the Accord? I was going to say agreement, but it was the Paris Accord.
Same thing.
Okay. Paris Agreement. And so that policy shapes culture, right? It shapes how now other countries are viewing us. And so I think it's important that when we talk about changing culture, changing, you know, activating people, that we really, and I'm always trying to, you know, reel my activist friends in and say, okay, well, what is a policy that you think we really should advocate for that would work to change this? Because when governments pass laws and initiate policies, the people and the public react to it in whatever way. And so sometimes it's a good policy and the public reacts to it in a bad way. And sometimes it's a bad policy and the public reacts to it in a bad way. So I think it's important that we also look at, like, the policies and initiatives that we are, I guess, passing, right, and legislating, because that stuff has, like, long-term effects on the culture.
And I would also argue it goes both ways.
Yeah.
Like, culture has such, you know, we have a role in shaping policy, as you said. Mm-hmm. I mean, constituents, policymakers care about their constituents because that's, you know, who keeps them in their job. Mm-hmm. But vice versa. So this, like, acknowledging it in both directions is so important. And You touched on something else that I think is important to like emphasize in terms of the having the difficult conversations that are close to home. You know, I've been working in environmental issues for a long time now, like 20 years, and you know, I've been do public outreach all the time, and I could convince a crowd of strangers, you know, of anything, and I feel comfortable. Like it doesn't, I don't get nervous, whatever. Knew one person was gonna have something negative to say about it, because you know she always does. And then I knew, you know, this, and because it's like I have to interact with these people forevermore, and I want to interact with them, but you know, similarly with the family, so that to not underestimate the importance of those hard stuff, which is usually where we also have the most influence, right, on our peers. You know, I love that you brought that up. I wanted to open it up again for more questions. And also for online questions, because I see quite a few of you online, and it is working for me to see questions online. So does anyone have other questions before we move on?
Yes, I was thinking about how it's turning into something very fashionable the latest years. And from my point of view, that can be something very good. It's like a great advertising or marketing strategy we could all use. Like I started using metal straws for the reasons I don't want to use plastic, and so many of my friends started using them because they look good on their Instagram pictures, which is kind of dumb. But then again, it's like, okay, they have the metal straws, they're not using plastic anymore, so it might not be the best way to start it, but then again, there's a change going on. So what do you guys think about that as a strategy in order to move forward?
It just starts off, I mean, like, from sort of a psychological perspective, I think it works quite well, because if you do a certain behavior and like you do it repeatedly, it becomes eventually a habit, and then kind of like doing it repeatedly and like becoming a habit, then you know like whatever you do kind of just influences your attitudes too. Because like sort of like big theme and in psychology it's like, you know, called cognitive dissonance, which is when like something you do like doesn't align with your like views. So you know like sometimes for instance someone who like, you know, drives a big truck and that's just like very important to them, you know, and then you would like tell them of one thing, oh, like this is bad for the environment, you like should be doing this, and they're like, well, but I'm doing this and I don't want this all, like, you know, internally, like I don't want to be a bad person, so then I change my attitude, oh, it's actually not that bad for the environment. So like taking this the like other way, that like if people engage in things and kind of like see, well, hey, the norm, everybody's doing it, and then you're like, now I'm doing it repeatedly, so it's actually good, so yeah, like this is a good thing to do, everybody should be doing this. So I think it's kind of almost a clever way to try to get people to engage and to do it repeatedly, and then that might change attitudes and like beliefs about topics.
I mean, there's a reason why advertising tries to make it seem like all the cool kids are doing X, Y, whatever it is. So that still matters. People want to be accepted. They want to be seen as part of a desirable group. And I was even reading like captains of airplanes, if they were told to take off at a certain point, they could affect the CO2 levels of the flight, and when certain pilots were told that every other pilot in their peer group was doing it, they started doing it. And so it's very effective in terms of, I think that's important, I don't discount it at all, I think it's a great way to start getting people to adopt some different ways of doing things. Because that's what it comes down to, is I can't keep doing the same thing the way I've been doing now. What's a new way to do it? And the subtle approach instead of the preaching way ends up being very effective without long-term adoption.
I would add, I mean, it comes back to what we were talking about earlier of knowing your audience. That's not going to work. I mean, fads also fade. You know, if you look at fashion, you know, every couple months it's something else we're supposed to be wearing. But knowing in your peer group, if that's like the Instagram photo is important, and having something cool that looks good and that you can also feel good about is something that's a priority, or at least something that's important in their lives, then that is going to be a great thing to get them involved. I think that's a great example of that. Did you have something to say?
No, I mean, the only thing I was going to say, I think it's great to get people to the conversation. I'm always worried that it's not a sustainable model, but I think it, I agree, it's like a really good way to like get people involved, and like there's all of these things that have been taboo now that are like settling sexy. Even like the social justice space is like kind of cool to be like in it. So, I would rather not. I don't like protesting. I actually really try not to. But it's like cool, right? It's cool to go out to a protest. Like, it's cool to go to a march now, where it's like maybe for certain people that wasn't cool at a certain point. But I'm always, and I've had this conversation internally within even the Women's March organization, and you know, as the Women's March organization is trying to figure out how to position themselves after doing the march, you know, like doing things like on the fly, like, oh my gosh, like Trump did this, and like reacting to that, that's great. But it's just to me, like, it kind of is like a fad, right? Like, everything that he does, maybe we should react to it, maybe we shouldn't, right? Maybe there should be a way to like have a long-term strategy on how we continue to keep people engaged. So once they're there because they have a cool metal straw, right? Like, how do we, like, how do we keep right. them engaged yeah. in like climate change and things that will make our ecosystem better? And I think that's what we have to think about. Like, once we get them there and like buy this cool thing, which is great because it works, like, how do we keep them there
yeah.
and not, you know, lose them when something else comes about that maybe is in disagreement with
yeah.
how we feel?
Or the fad changes and it's not cool anymore, so that
yeah.
we don't, that you've become so personally engaged by that point where you're doing it, originally you were doing it for that Instagram photo, but then suddenly it becomes something more.
Right.
And yeah, and we're actually, one of our, I don't remember which month, but one of our later Impacts Hours is going to be exactly on this topic of, for one, how do we not burn out? Because we've seen a lot of, and this is something you can probably talk to around the Women's March, we see a lot of new people in activism now this year. And for people who have been in it for a long time, I'm pointing to myself because I know this from experience, like, there's a certain level that you just can't physically and emotionally sustain in terms of, like, going to a protest even every week is, like, after a while, it's like the gym. You know, everyone goes to the gym in January and February because of New Year's resolutions, and then March, not so much. So, like, how do you keep people engaged and then push them wherever they are is to help get you to the next level. So that, and I think that speaks to your point a lot. I think there was a question in the back. Yeah.
I did, and it speaks to listening to your audience. And I'm sorry, I don't know your name, the woman in the middle. But you had mentioned focus groups, and I'm just wondering, is there access to that data? Can other groups access these focus groups so we can learn more, or does each group now have to perform their own focus groups?
I mean, in research, like, typically, whatever you want to do a study on, you, like, do your own, because, you know, like, the questions are so nuanced and are, like, you know, so different. So, in terms of, like, research data, you know, you could probably, like, if you, like, read an article that you find interesting and it kind of, like, talks about some of that, you, like, reach out to the authors and kind of, like, ask them to, like, share some of, like, their lessons learned. In terms of, you know, sort of, like, what, like, other groups or, like, organizations maybe do, like when they have conversations. I don't know if that's more open. I don't know. I can't even speak to that. But, yeah, for research, it would be reaching out to the authors of the paper.
Yeah, thank you.
I think a lot of that is, I mean, that comes back to what Natasha brought up earlier, is, you know, if you're working with a particular community, really reaching out to people who have been doing that for a long time already, because they might not have done a focus group, but they've probably had a lot of community meetings and gotten a lot of feedback from, you know, people participating in events or just talking about, you know, commenting on their work. So really, you know, I think there's a lot of opportunity in local partnerships, and that could be with elected officials. I mean,
mm-hmm.
they certainly collect a lot of data about their
mm-hmm.
constituents and are always looking for community partners. Maybe you can speak to that more. But,
yeah.
you know, local nonprofits and schools, you know, educators as well.
Yeah. I think the question would be, you know, what type of information are you trying to collect? Because a lot of it is public, especially, like, certain research, especially if you're getting public dollars. It has to be published somewhere. And so I'm sure a lot of that is probably published on the site, or you can find it somewhere. So I think it would just be a matter of like what you're trying to collect. And then I guess either one of us figuring out how to point you to a place or entity that probably has some of the information that you're looking for.
Any other questions?
Another question about platform. So you talked about Instagram. You mentioned the social media world and how you know, insular that can be, and you're talking to your own people. What platforms do you see as useful for reaching people who are not in your little circle? You know, tangible things. You know, is it a website? Is it a contact? What are you trying to do?
It's tricky because what draws different audiences has tended to become so polarized these days in terms of, you know, a Netflix show only targeting certain people based on algorithms. But I think in terms of reaching other audiences, YouTube is really interesting in terms of like the searchability. It ends up being not so focused. I think it's also including the different keywords in terms of like when you are posting on a platform. The things that are connected, like Facebook, that's difficult to reach outside because you have your network's already established. So it's getting outside of things that are so structured that way. Medium is difficult also because that ends up shouting to certain people and not others, but I think it's more like a point of view and a perspective. If it ends up being broad enough, that's it'll appeal to more people. And once you get outside of the very specific friend-based social media circles, you have a chance of intersecting with other people who might come across it.
I've actually come across this website called Minds.com. It's a
M-I-N-E-S?
Minds, yeah. It's a social media platform. They are open source, and they don't use any logarithm for people to only reach their crowd, so people that follow them. So what they do is you boost your posts, and then everyone on the social media page can actually see your posts. So I think that's pretty interesting. Mm-hmm. It's new, it's coming along. I think they might have 1 million people subscribed. But so far, they're
pretty interesting. And I would say not underestimating just like personal connections. Mm-hmm. Like going to an event that you normally wouldn't go to, you know, a different interest, a meetup, and talking with people. I mean, we certainly, those connections last a lot longer than the Facebook post, you know, and impact us in different ways. Because, you know, I connect with you as opposed to your views, which is a lot harder to do when there's like screen between us. And that's something, and maybe you have some thoughts on this, Natasha, but I've heard that a lot from politicians as well, is, you know, sending the email, great, but how important is each individual email to your life, you know? But the handwritten letter with the personal story, you know, or the phone call conversation, or the meeting.
There's this like this model that they say like in campaigning, but I always look at everything as a way to apply it to something else. And so there's this model that you're supposed to have. So to get someone to like actually show up to the poll for you, and you can look at it, even if to get someone to actually care about your issue, is they say you should have 7 touches, right, with that person. So the one touch could be a Facebook post, another touch could be a tweet. I don't know. Another touch could be the personal. You went to their door. You knocked on their door. Another touch is maybe you saw them at an event. Another touch is the letter, a personalized letter. Another touch is a phone call. And another touch could be another mailer, right? But they say that, like, you really want to ensure that you get someone to the poll, not to say they'll vote for you because maybe that'll only take 3 touches, but, like, for them to actually go to the poll and vote for you, you should have 7 touches. And I think that if you think about that, and you know, as you think about social media, then you know, you need to like kind of expand it outside of social media. And I think messaging is really important. It's something that I'm always interested in, how people message things and how everybody receives a message. And I think both of you all are probably, I'm just like a groupie for it, but I don't really like do it as a study, but like I'm always interested in like when like
crisis things happen, how like they, like the entity itself, like messages themselves, and how like the press picks it up. And so I think messaging is really important when you're trying to reach other people. You can't message the same way, and it's literally like following the same theme and like speaking other people's language, because you know, even if your post is going to all of these people that are typically not your demographic or not a part of the same choir that you're a part of, if your messaging is still tailored to your network, they're gonna just scroll past it. So I think making sure that your messaging is able to reach a large audience or reach the audience that you're trying to reach is really important on top of this whole seven
so much work. It's so good.
Seven touches, yeah.
I love that you said that about the messaging, because I mean, I've experienced many times where I thought I was communicating in a way that was very open and not showing all of my many biases, and I've been told that I wasn't. So like that comes back to how we started, was the listening, is that, you know, it's a continual process of communicating and listening to, honestly listening to that feedback too, to make sure that, you know, I think of this with my personal relationships with my husband. I often will communicate something and he hears something very different, you know, and we've all had that experience in personal relationships. So it doesn't end with that, you know, it's, we continue that into our work. We have about 5 more minutes. Any other thoughts?
I was just going to say on that point, when we were doing the Black Eyed Peas tour, the theme was energy never dies.
Mm.
And what was interesting about that, what I've thought about that since, is that it was broad enough to mean, to give the space for people to bring their own meaning to that, but specific enough that it gave people an idea to get behind. And I think that's the trick when it comes to messaging some of these things, is speaking to people in different ways, is how can the message be inclusive, but then also specific enough and exciting where people want immediately have their own reactions and personal investment in it. And some of what the Women's March did definitely started to touch on that, and I think it's just about continuing that in terms of keeping people engaged. It gets, where is the broad enough message that gets people excited in the long run, and gives an umbrella where people feel like they are bringing their own agency and experiences into that meaning as well.
That's why we need you. Well, all of you, which is why we have you. Any other final thoughts?
I did add like 1,000 feet to like the platform question, you know, also like recognizing the benefits and the advantages, maybe that there's not like one platform that just speaks to everybody, like really embracing, you know, like for us in like saying like going to like different conference with like different audiences, and you might have to like, you know, shoot how you like talk about things, or you know, like when you're sort of like looking into like education and like working with like schools, like first like listening, seeing like what would work for them, and then kind of like tailoring your message to that, which is going to be very different if you're like, you know, in the political field or like in like a neighborhood group that, you know, where they come together and like talk about it. And I think, you know, although it might seem like small when you're like, you know, in this like little neighborhood group or like, you know, us here now talking about it, but like that goes a long way, because like we each talk to someone and like we will inspire others. And I think, you know, it's little steps, but like that is going to be like power, that it just kind of like grows larger and larger, but with like messages that actually touch everybody and then they carry it forward. So
Well, ladies, thank you so much for sharing your amazing experience. I hope this isn't the last conversation and spark for action that we do together. I really appreciate your time and appreciate all of you for joining. I just wanted to let you know also, our next impact hour is a lunchtime learning. We're alternating between breakfast and lunch. And it's July 13th, and we're actually, it'll be a great continuation of this, because we're looking at collaboration across borders, and this, looking at this idea of alliances and being a good ally that we're starting to talk about more and more, but what does that really mean? Practically, how do we do that? And we have 3 really exciting people. We have Karen Johnson, who is a researcher and systems designer at Openbox. As our artist, our activist is Jacqueline Patterson, who's the Director of Environmental and Climate Justice at the NAACP. And then Chris Kennedy, who has a PhD in Education and Cultural Studies, and does a lot on looking at nature to learn about how to do societal thing. So it should be, I hope you guys can all join us on that too. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.